Dr. Nasser Siddiqui, stricken with an incurable disease, then miraculously healed by the power of God. The powerful ministry of Dr. Nasser Siddiqui is equipping God's people to be successful in every area of life, marriage, family, business, and more. Touching the world, touching lives, touching you. This is Winning with Wisdom Interactive.
Hello everyone, welcome to Winning with Wisdom Interactive, our new program where you get to ask the questions and together we study the Word of God. I, of course, am Dr. Nasser Siddiqui. Thank you for joining me today on Winning with Wisdom Interactive. What questions do you have for the Lord on prosperity? That's what we're going to study. You've sent in many of the questions and you can send in more. Of course, go to Twitter, Facebook, or call us at 888-947-3660. I'll say that again. You can send your questions through Twitter, Facebook, or you can call us. Call me direct at 888-947-3660. What are your questions today? We're going to study biblical prosperity. Now, let's go to question number one. Does God want us to prosper? Good question. Good question. For many years, we've been taught to be broken, humble for Jesus. But is that scriptural? Is that what the Bible says? You know, Jesus is the living Word. The Word became flesh and so dwelt among us. So therefore, if Jesus is the Word become flesh and dwelt among us, then the Word is what we must honor and we must put higher than any doctrine of man, any religious doctrine, any denominational doctrine. We got to stay with the Word of God. Don't follow a man, not even me. Don't follow anybody. Follow Jesus. He's the only one that can save you, heal you, deliver you, and set you free. All right. So what does Jesus say? What does the Word say about prosperity? The first scripture we're going to go to is 3 John 2. John is writing to one of his spiritual sons, Gaius. And this is what he says in 3 John 2. Beloved Gaius, I pray that you may prosper in every way. Isn't this interesting? I pray that you would prosper in every way, and that you will keep well, even in health, as your soul prospers. Now let's break that down. Who is this guy John anyway? Well, he lived with Jesus, walked with Jesus, learned to pray with Jesus. If anybody knew how to pray, it would be John. If anybody knew the will of God from Jesus, it would be John. How many people you and I know actually walked with Jesus? Not your pastor, not your bishop, not your apostle, not your prophet. They never walked with Jesus, but John did. Look at what John says. Beloved Gaius, I pray. He's actually asking God that Gaius would prosper. So how can we possibly believe that poverty is from the Lord? Prosperity is from the Lord. Those of you that have children, are you happy when your children are broke, when they're struggling and they're in poverty? Of course not. You would love them that way. You love them so much that you want to see your children prosper. Well, how much more, hello, does our Heavenly Father want to see His children prosper? So don't buy into this thing about being broke for Jesus. There's no scripture for it. It's not in the Word of God. We're going to stick with the Word. What does John pray? Beloved guys, I pray that you would prosper in all things. He didn't even say, well, just prosper spiritually. No. It's not what he said. He said, prosper in all things, spiritually, financially, mentally, in your family, in your marriage, in your business, in your job. He wants you to prosper in every way and be in health. Oh my goodness, as your soul prospers. Now, why are so many people struggling if, of course, God wants us to prosper? Well, the answer was right there. If condition, even as your soul prospers. Now I'm going to take you to another scripture. You want to dig into this. Is it God's will for you to prosper? I found this scripture in Psalms 35:27. Psalms 35:27. Let's go over there and let's study it together. Let those who favor my righteous cause, God is talking now, my righteous cause have pleasure in my uprightness. Let them shout for joy and be glad and say continually, let the Lord be magnified who takes pleasure in the poverty of his servants. No. Brother Nasser, it does not say poverty. Pastors say poverty. Denominations say poverty. But doctrines of men say poverty. That's not the Word says. The Word says God takes pleasure in the prosperity. Oh my goodness. Yes, of his servants. If he wants his servants to prosper, how much more does he want his children to prosper? How much more does he want his sons and daughters to prosper? All right, let's break it down. Let those who favor my righteous cause. What is God's cause? None should perish. Are you funding the gospel? Are you sending your money where people can get saved? Are you sending your money where people can receive the uncompromised word of God? Are you getting people saved? What are you doing? If you're interested in his cause, that none should perish, then you should keep reading. Let those who favor my righteous cause and have pleasure in my uprightness, let them shout for joy and say continually. I wonder why he said the word continually. Because if we don't say this continually, we'll fall into men's doctrine. What's men's doctrine? It's supposed to be broke for Jesus. Oh, if you got money, you can't be serving Jesus. If you're wealthy, you can't be serving Jesus. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Well, doesn't the Bible say that money is the root of all evil? No, it does not. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Money doesn't have the capacity to be evil. It doesn't have the capacity to be good. Money is for whatever it's used for. If you use it for evil things, yes, then money is used for evil things. But how many of you know you can use money to bring the gospel all over the world? You can use money to send this broadcast all over the world. You can use money for missions that are struggling in China and Africa and India so they can be fed and they can bring the gospel and they can bless other people. Money can be used as a blessing. That's what it should have been. Money doesn't have the capacity to be good or bad. Money is just a tool depending on whose hands it's in. That's why it's so important that we use it in the right hands. Money is not your problem. It is the love of money. Now, what do we say? Let those who favor my righteous cause, let them shout for joy and say continually, let the Lord be magnified who takes pleasure in the what? Prosperity. Now, the word prosperity is an interesting word. I did a study on this. See, I don't like to necessarily believe what it says in the English because the Bible was never written in English. It was written in Hebrew and it was written in Greek. So I like to go to the Hebrew word. The Hebrew word for prosperity here is the word shalom. What? The word shalom. Isn't it interesting? The translators who translated King James in Isaiah 9:6, don't go over there, it's translated that Jesus is the Prince of Peace. But that's not what the original says. The original says Jesus is the Prince of Shalom. Oh my goodness. And they decided they were going to translate it Prince of Peace in Isaiah. Now when we come to Psalms 35:27, the same translators, they looked at this scripture and they said, let the Lord be magnified who takes pleasure in the shalom of his people. In the what? Shalom of his people. Only this time they decided they were not going to use the word a peace for shalom. They were going to use the word prosperity. Now, why is it that the translators in Isaiah decided to use the word shalom and translate it to peace? Yet in Psalms, the same word shalom, they translated to prosperity. Why did they do that? Aha! I did a study on the word shalom. Are you ready? When a Jewish man says to another Jewish man, shalom, he doesn't just mean peace. The word shalom means, I wish for you, brother, prosperity, peace, great wealth, health, favor, all be well, nothing missing, nothing broken. Oh my goodness. Shalom means all of that? Yep, shalom means all of that. That's why when we call Jesus the Prince of Peace, wrong translation. He was the Prince of Shalom. What does it mean? Jesus is the Prince of Shalom. It means this. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the Prince of Prosperity. He's the Prince of Great Wealth. He's the Prince of Health. He's the Prince of Favor. He's the Prince of All Be Well. He's the Prince of Nothing Missing, Nothing Broken. Oh my goodness. How can you sit there, Brother Nasser, and say Jesus is the Prince of Prosperity? Because the Bible says it. There are churches all over America and around the world. If I went to the pulpit and I said Jesus is the Prince of Prosperity, they would stone me and ask for Barabbas. Come on now. That religious doctrine out there to keep Christians broke. The devil has infiltrated the church with stuff that is totally, completely unscriptural. My brothers and sisters, the greatest advice I can give you is your friend, stay with the word. Not men, God's word. Now we see, God pleasures in the prosperity of his servant. Is it God's will for you and I to prosper? Well, let me ask you a question. Do you want to make God happy? You want to keep him sad? Stay broke. You want to make him happy? Start to prosper. God's will is not for you to be sick and broke for Jesus. That is totally unscriptural. You've got to stay with the Word of God. What does the Word say? God pleasures in the prosperity of His servants. We're going to study this. How do I prosper? Who's responsible for my prosperity? How does all of this come about? But the main thing we've got to get changed in our mindset, is it God's will for you and I to prosper? And the answer, my brothers and sisters, is definitely yes, 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 yes. If you're watching a TV program, a television evangelist, or in your conference or in a church service, and they're talking about be broke and sick for Jesus, don't walk away, run. It is totally, completely unscriptural. And you know what? We have got to stay with the Word of God. We can't keep going with men's doctrines. God wants you to prosper in all things and be in health. Wants you to prosper in your health, wants you to prosper in your business, wants you to prosper in your finances, wants you to prosper in every area of your life. My brothers and sisters, if God finds pleasure in the prosperity of His servants, why do we criticize one another when they start to prosper? Why do we do that? Don't you know that God is no respecter of persons? If He loves you, He loves them. If they're prospering, guess what? Maybe they're doing some of the word that you're not doing. But if you learn the word, what did He say? Beloved, I pray that you would prosper in all things and be in health condition, even as your soul prospers. Soul is the word psuche, mind, will, intellect, and emotion. When I renew my mind with God's word, then I'll see prosperity. So if you see somebody prospering, don't get jealous, don't get envious. Put up your hand and shout, next. You're in the same line, my brothers and sisters. God is no respecter of persons. Maybe they've studied the word a little bit more than you. Maybe they're living the word a little bit more than you. Maybe they've found in here things that we, our part of the covenant, need to do to see that prosperity come into our lives. My brothers and sisters, remember, God wants you to prosper in every area of your life, especially in finances. Why, Brother Nasser, why does God want me to prosper in finances? Listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you. Drug dealers will not fund the gospel. Sinners will not fund the gospel. God wants that gospel to go to every man, woman, and child on planet Earth. If Christians don't prosper, who is going to fund the gospel? God wants you to prosper. God, oh Lord, can I say this? God needs you to prosper. Why? Then He will use you not just to be blessed, my brothers and sisters, but to be a blessing. God wants you to prosper. Why? So you can fund the gospel around the world. Whether it's ministries like ours, bringing the word of God, or missions work, or evangelism, or your local church, whatever it is, you need to get involved. And how can you bless someone else when you can't pay your rent? That's why we got to learn the word of God, so you can start to prosper. Then He will use you to bring the gospel all over the world.
You don't have to live with financial struggles any longer. God has already provided everything you need to live an abundant life. Your prosperity lies in your hands as you follow His kingdom principles for financial increase. In His life-changing 6-CD series, Dr. Nasser Siddiqui teaches you biblical principles to lead you out of lack and into God's abundant life of prosperity and success. Kingdom Principles of Financial Increase is available on 6 CDs for your ministry gift of $30 or more when you call toll-free 1-888-947-3660. Write to Wisdom Ministries, Box 4700, Tulsa, Oklahoma, 74159, or visit wisdomministries.org. Dr. Siddiqui's dynamic teaching is available in a companion book as well, along with the 6-CD set for your best ministry gift of $40 or more. Order Kingdom Principles of Financial Increase today.
Wisdom Ministries, we started listening. My husband was flipping through the TV and found Dr. Siddiqui online and started listening to him. And we started listening to the CDs at night while we were sleeping and noticed that after we had started listening to him, that the company that I worked for was paying me wrong. They retroactively owed me for 2 or 3 months, and that was about 4 or 5 months ago. And then this past summer, they also did the same thing. I got a raise and owed me for like 4 months and paid me retroactive. So it's been a financial blessing, definitely.
Welcome back to Winning with Wisdom Interactive. Of course, I'm Dr. Nasser Siddiqui, and together we're studying biblical prosperity, where you get to ask your questions, and together we study the Word of God. Of course, you know you can send your questions to us through Twitter, Facebook, and you can call us at 888-947-3660. That number will be on your screen, 888-947-3660, to ask your questions. Of course, the first question that came up was, does God want you and I to prosper? We touched on that one. John said, "The beloved, I pray you would prosper in all things and be in health." In Psalms, we were there where it says that God actually pleasures in the prosperity of his servants. Now, we know that prosperity is from the Word of God. We know that God wants us to prosper, and yet there's so many Christians struggling. Why? Let's study the next question. That is, of course, who is responsible for my prosperity? So now, who is responsible for my prosperity? Let's go to Joshua 1:8, and we will study the word on who is responsible for my prosperity. Joshua 1:8, you find out that Joshua is about to take over leadership to 2 to 3 million Jews. Moses is dead. He's taking them over to the promised land. And he says, "Lord, how am I going to do this? How am I going to take them over to the promised land?" And here comes the word of the Lord. "This book of the law, the word of God, shall not depart out of your mouth, but you'll meditate on it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then," watch this, "you will make your way prosperous." So even if we finally get to the point where we believe it is God's will for you and I to prosper, we're still waiting for God to prosper us. And yet that's not what it says here in the Word of God. It says, "You will make your way prosperous." Now, how did this happen? If Joshua could make Joshua's way prosperous, and we can find out what Joshua did, and we do what Joshua did, maybe we can make our way prosperous. So let's break it down. What was it that God said to Joshua? "This book of the law," the Word of God. The Word of God. Now, it's very interesting. It says here, "This book of the law, the Word of God, shall not depart from your mouth." It almost makes it sound like that you shouldn't even speak the word out of your mouth. It shouldn't depart out of your mouth. So I did a study in the original Hebrew. I want to find out, what does this really say? And it never said that at all. We're back to the old translators again. That's why it's good to go to the Greek and the Hebrew. Find out what really happened. Here's what I found out. "The word of God shall not be removed from your mouth." What does that mean? That means it should be always in your mouth. Ah, that sounds a whole lot better. "This book of the law," or "the word of God, shall not depart out of your mouth." It means it should never be removed from your mouth. It means that it would always be in your mouth. It means if you open your mouth, guess what? The word will fall out. When I was a little boy growing up, we had a little candy. It was a round ball. It was like a golf ball. It was about that big, and it was called a jawbreaker. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Might be aging me now, but there you go. Jawbreaker. What was this jawbreaker? It was a round candy. It was a big ball. You stick it in your mouth, and Mom would say, "Come for dinner," and all you could go was, You couldn't even talk with this thing. It consumed your whole mouth. You tried to bite it, you would lose 3 teeth. You'd have to suck on it for 3 days before it ever went. You know what I'm talking about. And while you had it in your mouth, if you ever did open your mouth, it would fall out. When you open your mouth today, what falls out? The word? Really? Are you busy telling God how big your problem is? Or are you busy telling your problem how big your God is? Which one is coming out of your mouth? Which word is falling out of your mouth? See, Joshua was told, don't let the word be removed from your mouth. In other words, the only word that should come out of your mouth is the Word of God. I tell pastors and ministers and other people that want to take me to lunch or dinner, please don't take me to lunch or dinner. I'm the most boring person you want to meet. Why? Because all I want to do is talk about the Word. Pinch me and the Word falls out. The Word, the Word, the Word, the Word. Why? Because I know if it could make Joshua prosperous, guess what? It can make you and I. So he says, don't let the word ever be removed from your mouth. Don't let the word of God depart from your mouth, but you will meditate. Now, what is that word meditate? The word meditate happens to be the Hebrew word to think, to consider, to ponder, to mutter. You will meditate. You will think, you will consider, you will ponder, you will mutter. You'll think on the word, How often do I need to think on the word? Actually, two other translations, my favorite ones, is pre-play in your mind or rehearse in your mind. You will think, you will consider, you will ponder, you will mutter, you'll pre-play in your mind or you'll rehearse in your mind the word. How often should I rehearse the word in my mind? Bible says you should rehearse it day and night. Meditate on my word day and night. Day and night. My brothers and sisters, when is it not day? Oh my goodness, when it's night. When is it not night? When it's day. So what does that mean? I got to think on the word all day. I got to think on the word all night. Wait a minute. If I'm thinking on the word all day and all night, how much time I got left over to think on my problem? That's my point. None. So the more you think on your problem, the less you think on the word, you're not going to do what Joshua did. Watch this now. And you're not going to get what Joshua got. That's why it's so important. We got to do what Joshua did. Why do we meditate on the word? So that we can memorize scriptures? No. Jesus doesn't care how many scriptures you memorize. He wants to know how many do you live? How many scriptures are you living? Those are the only ones that make a difference in your life. So we have to meditate on the word. Why? Think on the word day and night so that we will be doers. Do. No, not just memorize scriptures. So that you will do, watch this now, do all. Now, from the state that you're in, and the country you're watching me from, what does the word all mean? Of course it means all, Brother Nasser. That's my point. You don't pick the scriptures you like. Oh, Lord, I like that one. Rejoice, and again I say rejoice. That's a good one. I like that one. But that tithing one, not crazy about that. The one about being a house of prayer, not crazy about. No. All still means all. So that you will do all that is written in it. All that is written in what? The word. God wants you to be a doer of the word, not just a hearer only. So you will do all that's written in it. So what happens now? What if I think on the word day and night? If I do the word, then it says you will make you prosperous, not God. See, we're waiting on God to prosper us. God's waiting on us. We think that God's going to do it. God already wrote in the word. No. You will make you prosperous. How? You've got to do what Joshua did. Keep the word in your mouth. Meditate on the word day and night. Think about it. Why? Because what you think about changes what you do. And what you do produces a result in your life. If you're struggling in any area of your life today, you're struggling in finances, you're struggling in marriage, you're struggling in health, you're struggling with your kids. Why am I struggling, Brother Nasser? Because you've never done the word concerning that item or that issue. Why? Because you've never meditated on the word that deals with that issue. What are you trying to say, Brother Nasser? I'm saying this. If you're going through a struggle in your health, you're going through a struggle in your wealth, if that's what's going on, or even in your marriage, to change that area of your life, you have to change what you do. But you'll never change what you do until you change what you think. That's why he says meditate, number one, so that you'll be a doer. Number two, so it'll produce a result in your life. Number three, so you say, Brother Nasser, my marriage is struggling. What should I do? How do I fix my marriage? Step number one, start finding scriptures from the Word of God. Meditate on those scriptures. Think on those scriptures day and night. Why? Then you will live them. You will do them, not just memorize scriptures. And then doing the Word, watch this, produces a result in your life. Well, Brother Nasser, I'm sick now. What have I got to do? Number one, find scriptures to deal with healing. What have I got to do? Meditate, think on them, pre-play in my mind, rehearse them in my mind. How often should I do that, Brother Nasser? Day and night. If I'm constantly thinking of the word, not my problem, then I will be a doer of the word, not a hearer only, and it'll produce a result in my life. What about finances? Well, why am I sick and broke right now? Because you haven't been meditating on the word. We've got to find lots of scriptures, and we've got lots of CDs that can help you do that. Every time I finish teaching, we go to a commercial, there are CDs that can help you think on the word, meditate on the word. And if you will do that, listen to them 24/7. Listen to them while you sleep at night, while you're driving your car. Listen to the word, get it in you so that you become a doer of the word. Then, look out, you will make you prosperous. Why? I'm teaching you something that this scripture teaches. It's called the law of thoughts. What is the law of thoughts, Brother Nasser? What you think about, you will do. What you do will produce a result in your life. So if you want to see a change in the result in the area of finances, you got to change what you do. But before you can ever change what you do, you got to change what you think, what you meditate on. That's what God was trying to teach Joshua. Joshua, you'll never see success until you deal with this. And then he says, you will make you prosperous. The word prosperous means to push forward and break out. Prosperous in your marriage, with your children, in your health, in your finances, in your business, your job. Every area of your life will prosper if you will learn to do this. Like I said, we've got many, many CDs. I encourage you to get them. In my house, we play them all night because your ear gate is open. And guess what? Your spirit man is receiving the word. The mind is receiving the word. And that word is getting into you so that now it can learn to get out of you. What have I got to do? Think on the word. Do the word. See the result of the word. You'll never see healing in your life if all you do is think about your sickness. You'll never see prosperity in your life if all you think about is your poverty. You got to change what you think so you can change what you do. Then you will change the result in your life. My brothers and sisters, if it's on your mind, look out, look out, look out. It's in your future. You better be careful what's on your mind. You ever notice the front windshield of your car is a whole lot bigger than that rearview mirror? You know why that is. So you can look forward a whole lot more than you look back. Stop wasting precious thinking time thinking of your past. You cannot change your past. Nobody can change your past. It is finished. But you can waste your future by thinking of your past. Remember, if it's on your mind, it's in your future. So who is responsible for my prosperity? You and I. What have we got to do? Meditate on the word. Listen to the word. Get that faith built up. Hear the word. We think on the word day and night. We become doers of the word. Then we're going to see prosperity manifest in us. So get some of these materials. Invest in yourself. You're worth it. You'll never see a change in your life until you start getting those scriptures in that area inside of you. How do you do that? By listening to the word. Listening to the word. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Get those scriptures on the inside of you. Think about them day and night. Then become a doer of the word, not a hearer only. Guess what? Once you think of the word, become a doer of the word, then, my brothers and sisters, you will make you prosperous, and you will see good success in every area of your life.
Debt and mismanagement of the seed God has entrusted you will eventually become a weight that will hinder your effectiveness for the kingdom.
Can't do it your way and wonder why God ain't going to bless you. If you want God to bless you, you're going to have to do it His way.
In Dr. Nasser Siddiqui's practical and relevant new 6-CD teaching series titled Managing Money God's Way, you'll discover why God expects you to generate money and prosper, how fear, doubt, and greed affect your finances, and much, much more. Managing Money God's Way is available today for your ministry donation of $25 or more. Call toll-free 1-888-947-3660. Write to Wisdom Ministries, Post Office Box 4700, Tulsa, Oklahoma 74159. Or order online at wisdomministries.org. With your order, you'll also receive a free copy of the Wisdom Magazine Miracles Edition to build your faith. Request Managing Money God's Way today.
My name is Brittany, and I came to Midwest. I live in Midwest City, and I came to Dr. Siddiqui's meetings at my church, and I've had lower back pain for since I can remember, and it's gone. He's healed me.
My name is Eugene Lane. I'm originally from Massachusetts, but I've been out here for the last 2.5 years. I had a heart procedure. I had stents put in my heart. And they said I have a blockage in my heart, and I have had back problems that couldn't hurt me to walk. And Dr. Siddiqui just turned around and healed me. He took the stick from me, and I can walk much better now. And in Jesus' name, I feel like I'm healed.
Welcome back to Winning with Wisdom Interactive. I'm Dr. Nasser Siddiqui, where you get to ask the questions, what is God's will on prosperity? And we get to study it together in the Word of God. course, we've been studying, is it God's will? Yes. We went through those scriptures already. Yes. Who's responsible for my prosperity? We found out if Joshua could make Joshua prosperous, you can make you prosperous. So we've got to do what Joshua did. Study, meditate the word of God. Now, I'm going to go to the next question that's coming. What does the thief come to steal? I went to John 10:10 to study that, and here's what I found out. The thief comes in order to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus says, I've come to give you life. Watch this now, watch this, and life more abundantly. Not barely make it life, not struggling life, not I can't pay my bills life. No, that's not why Jesus came. Jesus came to give you life more abundantly, abundant life. Now, how do we see that abundant life? Well, we've got to break this scripture down. If Jesus says there's a thief, guess what? There's a thief. And what does he do? He comes to your house to do three things: steal, kill, and destroy. Steal, kill, and destroy. Now watch this. Why isn't he called a killer? Why isn't he called a destroyer? Why is he called a thief? In fact, that word thief, just for your information, is the Greek word klepto. Yes, you're right. We get the English word kleptomaniac, someone that is always stealing. Now, what's he coming to steal? Coming to steal my health? No. Coming to steal my wealth? No. Coming to steal my kids? No. See, that's the whole point. My brothers and sisters, if you don't know what he's coming to steal, what are you protecting? Here comes the number one question. What's he coming to steal? When you put on the armor of God, you put on the helmet of salvation. You put on the breastplate of righteousness. You put on the belt of truth. Shod on your feet the preparation of gospel of peace. Pick up something called the shield of faith. And every part of this armor is defensive. You forgot the only offensive part of the armor, that is the sword of the Spirit. And for 2,000 years, the thief has kept Christians and their swords apart. Oh, Brother Nasser, he doesn't do that at my house. Really? How many times did you get excited about the Word of God? How many times did you say to God, I'm going to read my Bible every day? But guess what? You got busy and you didn't do it. Come on now, lift up your hands. Don't lie to the Holy Ghost. You know that you didn't do it. You allowed busyness to steal the Word. See, the devil was there, right there from the beginning of time when God spoke the Word and 400 billion galaxies showed up. He knows the power of the Word even more than most Christians. What's he trying to steal? The word. He can steal the word in the area of marriage, he'll destroy your marriage. If he can steal the word in the area of health, he'll kill your health. If he can steal the word in the area of prosperity, he'll destroy your prosperity. Whatever area he can steal the word is the only area he can kill and destroy. Don't let him steal the word on prosperity. The reason you're struggling right now is because you've never really spent a lot of time, effort, or even your own finances to study prosperity. But if you will change that, go get some of the CDs, listen to them, get the word of prosperity in you. Don't let the devil steal it. When he steals it, now he can kill you and destroy you in that area. Amen? Don't let him do that. Stop you going to church. Stop you buying some CDs. Oh, I could buy a hamburger for the price I'm paying for this. No, no, no. Man cannot live by hamburgers alone. Come on now. You need every word that proceeds out of the mouth. I learned that very early in my life, and I got CDs, books. I got it all. I wanted to listen, cassettes. I'm listening to the word 24-7, 24-7, 24-7. People come to me and say, how in the world did your ministry grow all over the world so quickly? Because I went after the word. I finally figured out what the thief was coming to steal. Stop me buying cassettes, stop me buying CDs, and stop me listening to the word. In my house, we listen to it all night. Why? So that in the morning, we have more word in us than we've had the night before. That's what I encourage you to do. Get some CDs, play them all night. Don't let him steal the word of God. Any area he can steal, the area he can kill you and he can destroy you. Now, let's go to our next question. Next question is, is it wrong to ask for things? Is it wrong to ask for things? Good question. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 says, for by his divine power, for his divine power has bestowed upon us all things that are to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who's called us. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Now, what's this? Has bestowed or given to us all things. Did you notice the word given is past tense? God isn't going to give you anything because he's already given you all things. My brothers and sisters, listen, listen, listen. All means everything. Things mean every stuff you need to fulfill God's plan for your life. So when we say, God, give me a car, give me a house, give me this, give me that, God doesn't even hear your prayer. Why? Because the Bible says he's already given you all things to life and godliness. Every time somebody cries out, save me, Lord, save me, Lord, the father turns to Jesus and says, Jesus, what's he talking about? And Jesus says, I don't know. 2,000 years ago, I went to the cross. I paid the price for the sins of all mankind. He doesn't have to go to hell. I guess he just don't know. God's people today are perishing for lack of money? No. Power? No. Anointing? No. Lack of knowledge. Woman cried out, heal me of my cancer, Lord. Heal me of my cancer. The father looks down and says, I don't know what she's talking about. Jesus, come here. Jesus, he's seated on the right hand of the father. Tell me, what's she talking about? Jesus looks on the scene and says, I don't know. 2,000 years ago, I bore stripes on my back. I carried every sickness and every disease, including cancer. She doesn't need to carry it. I guess she just don't know. God's people till today have perished for lack of knowledge. Man crying out, give me a car, Lord. Give me a house, Lord. Give me some things, Lord. The father turns to Jesus and says, what's this guy talking about? Jesus says, I don't know. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 says very clearly, says, cursed is he who hangs on a tree. I have redeemed him from the curse of the law. 16 curses were poverty. Cursed is he who hangs on a tree. And the next verse says, I've redeemed him to the blessings of Abraham. And Abraham was very rich. Oh, my brothers and sisters, the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost can't figure out why you're broke. Because we're waiting on God. Whereas the Bible clearly says, I have given you all things for life. Don't ask for things anymore. I'm convinced as a leader in the body of Christ, most Christians own far more than they presently possess, while they possess far less than they rightfully own. You say, Brother Nasser, how do you access these things? You don't pray about money anymore. You claim what you need. Tell Satan to get his hands off your finances and tell the ministering angels to bring in the harvest in the measure of your seed. My brothers and sisters, it's always been that way. Everything you need here, all abundance has been commanded. All harvest has been commanded. It is here right now waiting on you. How do you access all things? Through something called a seed. And that's why we got to go to 2 Corinthians. Next question, 2 Corinthians 9:10. What does God actually give? Well, 2 Corinthians 9:10 says, God don't give. Don't give cars. When you get to heaven, you're going to find out there's no cars in heaven, no car dealers in heaven, no furniture in heaven, no subdivisions in heaven. What does God give? And by the way, FedEx and UPS don't pick up from heaven. Everything you need to fulfill God's plan for your life is sitting on the earth right now. What does God give you? Seed. If you've got a need, guess what? God will give you seed. My brothers and sisters, listen, listen, listen. As long as the earth remains, day and night, winter and summer, heat and cold, Genesis 8:22, seed time and harvest shall not cease. Is the earth still here? Day and night still here? Winter and summer still here? Seed time and harvest still here? Yep. So everything you need is hidden in the seed. Every time you've got a need, my brothers and sisters, you better pray, because your need is not a shock to God. The fact that you've got a need is proof it's already here. You don't think seriously that God had an emergency meeting with him, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and they said, oh my goodness, she got a need. I didn't know she had a need. What are we going to do? No, God saw the end from the beginning. He knew your need long before you knew your need. What did he do? He gave you the right seed. Now, if you never plant that seed, you'll never see that need met. Now, it says in 2 Corinthians 9:10, God provides seed. Watch this now. Not cars, not houses, not furniture, but seed to who? The sower. Now, first of all, we got to get this thing clear. Every time you pray for a car, God will never give you a car, but he'll give you a car seed. Now, if we eat that seed, we just ate our car. If you never plant that seed, don't get mad at God. Because in the mind of God, he gave you the car seed. You never planted it. Now, I got it in my bank account. It ain't going to grow in your bank account. Got it in my wallet. Ain't going to grow in your wallet. Got it in my purse. Ain't going to grow in your purse. Seed can't grow until it hits the ground. What does God do? God gives seed, watch this, to the sower. Not to every Christian. Because every Christian's not a sower. Every seed, my brothers and sisters, comes with an assignment. You ask God for a house, he's going to give you a house seed. Ask him for a job, he's going to give you a job seed. Ask him for business, he's going to give you a business seed. Ask him for a car, he's going to give you a car seed. But he doesn't give seed to every Christian. Because, see, seed has inside it. Seed was never meant to live as a seed. Seed was always meant to bring a heart. So he only gives seed to the sower. Because only the sower will allow that seed to bring the harvest that was hidden in it all the time. Our brothers and sisters, don't ever cry to God for a need. Cry to God for seed. Why? The seed brings your harvest. It's got built in harvest. When you get the seed, you've got to ask God what to sow, and then you've got to pray and obey. Seed has always contained a harvest. You know, the answer to God's, when you pray to God, God's answer is very, very simple. Yes and amen. Well, you say, Brother Nasser, I've been praying for a house. And if God's answer is yes and amen, how come I ain't seen the house? Did you ever ask God what was the seed that will bring that house? Did you ever plant it where God told you? Did you ever let go of that seed? No. Therein lies the problem. We're waiting for God to give us a car with a big red ribbon parked outside our front door. That ain't going to happen. You don't have any cars. We're waiting for God to give us the job, the business, the house. That is not going to happen, but He will give us the right seed. Now, what have you got to do with that right seed? You've got to pray and obey. My brothers and sisters, the biggest problem in the church today, as far as seed time is concerned, is listen. We plant tomato seed, and we get mad at God because corn doesn't come. Corn will never come. Why? You didn't plant the right seed. Because what do? We don't ask God, what seed should I sow for my house, or my car, or my business, or my job? We just decide what we're going to throw in the bucket. Most of the time, we plant the wrong seed and wonder why the right harvest doesn't come. We get mad at God for this. Mm-mm. Everything you need is on the earth right now to fulfill God's plan. All you got to do is pray and obey. As you obey the Holy Ghost, He doesn't watch over your word. He watches over His. In fact, He told me the only harvest He's obligated to give you or give me is the seed He directed. Is it God's will? Yes. Is it up to us? Yes. Is it everything here on earth? Yes. What does a thief come to steal? The word. What will God give us to access all things? He'll give us the right seed. But we've got to pray and obey.
In his life-transforming new 6-CD series, Harness the Power of Money, Dr. Nasser Siddiqui will teach you how to be a wise steward of the resources God has given you.
Your success should always be in proportion to how your soul prospers. If finances come in faster than your soul is prospering, you're going to lose it.
In Harness the Power of Money, you'll learn the principles of sowing and reaping, the laws of financial wisdom, how to transition from debt to financial freedom, and much, much more. It's available for your seed gift of $25 or more today when you call toll-free 1-888-947-3660. Write to Wisdom Ministries, Post Office Box 4700, Tulsa, Oklahoma, or order online at wisdomministries.org. When you call, you'll also receive a free copy of Nasser and Anita Siddiqui's Wisdom Magazine Miracles Edition. Begin learning today how to harness the power of your money.
When I came to the conference last year, I sowed a seed over $4,000 into the ministry. On that seed that I sowed over $4,000, my daughter has come home from the nursing home where she had stayed over 2 years. And I have become debt-free, my house paid off, my credit cards paid off, and I've just been blessed.
After we started sowing into the good soil here at the Wisdom Ministry, God started blessing us over and over again. And one of the biggest things that happened was that we had a $1,000 medical bill that was wiped clean. Just Monday was a week ago. And also, I received a $40 a week raise. So we know that the Wisdom Ministry is good soil, and we're reaping the harvest from those seeds.
WisdomMinistries.org allows you to stay connected and up to date with upcoming events and teachings from Dr. Nasser Siddiqui. Free teaching downloads, videos on demand, free magazines, online store, live streamed events, and much more. All of Dr. Siddiqui's teachings are just a click away, wisdomministries.org.
Welcome back to Winning with Wisdom Interactive. I'm Dr. Nasser Siddiqui, where you get to ask the questions. I love this program where you ask me the questions, and together we study the Word of God. course, you can do it Twitter, you can do it Facebook, or you can call that 800 number on the screen. We'd love to get your questions, because I know together, if we study the Word of God, we will find the answers. What have we been studying? Biblical prosperity. Is it God's will for you and I to prosper? Yes. Went through some scriptures. It's all on those CDs. Number two, does God have enough? Absolutely, yes. 400 billion galaxies growing at the rate of 886,000 miles a second. He can handle your rent. Come on. Does he want to give? He loves to give. Why do God's people perish? Lack of money or lack of knowledge? Oh, you got it. Lack of knowledge. Now, what did we find out? All things are already here. Who's responsible for my prosperity? God or me? Me. You and I, just like Joshua was. And we found out that all things accessible by seed. Nothing is coming from heaven. FedEx, UPS, don't pick up in heaven. It's already here. But how do you access it? We found out that God doesn't give cars. 2 Corinthians 9:10. No. God gives seed. Who does he give seed to? The sower. Now let's study some more and find out what is the next question that came up. What does God give? Seed. And why does God give seed? So let's talk about this. Why does God give seed? Well, in John 12:24, it says, I assure you, Jesus is speaking now. He says, I assure you, most solemnly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat, a seed, falls into the earth and dies, it remains by itself alone. But if it dies, if what dies? The seed. It has to die to your purpose to accomplish God's purpose. If it dies, look at this, it brings forth the fruit or the harvest. Here we're waiting for God to be our delivery boy. God does not our delivery boy. He doesn't bring our harvest. The seed does. Where was the apple tree all these years? Hidden in the seed. Where was the orange tree all these years? Hidden in the seed. Where is the next car you're believing God for right now? Hidden in the seed. The house you need, the job you need, the business you need to get out of debt, the money you need is all hidden in the seed. And seed brings forth its purpose and destiny only if it's sown. Seed contains in it the supernatural blueprint of reproduction and increase. What does God give? He gives seed, but that seed has to die to your purpose to accomplish God's purpose. Remember what I told you, seed has in it a DNA. And that DNA will never come to pass if the seed never gets planted. I remember one time I was traveling to a place called Branson, Missouri, and we were driving on the highway from Springfield. And here's what I found out. From Springfield, they dynamited the rocks. When they dynamited the rocks, they put the highway in, and as I was driving on that highway, I saw a little tree about this big on the side of those rocks. How did that tree get in there? Well, a tiny little seed fell into the crack of that rock. Rain came, and guess what? The seed opened up, and it had enough power in it to send a root down and a stalk up with leaves and more seed. Where was all that power hidden all the time? It was hidden in the seed. Have you any idea how much power is hidden in your seed? My brothers and sisters, the seed contains power. Seed has three parts. The outer part is the husk, then the endosperm, the food storage zone, and right in the center of that seed is the embryo. What is the embryo? My harvest. That's exactly right. Where is my harvest hidden all the time? It has been hidden in the seed. That's why God is telling you what seed to plant. You can't throw anything in a bucket. You can't send any seed to any ministry that's feeding you like this one. You can't do that. You got to pray and obey. For too many years, Christians have been planting tomato seed, wonder why corn isn't going to come. Corn will never come. You can fast for 40 days and 40 nights, and still corn ain't going to come. You planted the wrong seed. The only harvest he's obligated to give you is the seed he directed. Now, let's go to the next scripture and the next question that came in, which was, who has my prosperity? I found the answer. Let's go to Luke 6:38. And Jesus said these words, give and it shall be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men pour into your bosom. See, I told you God doesn't have your harvest, men have it. Told you nothing is coming from heaven, it's already here. Some man living in your house, some man driving your car, some man has your job, your business, and your money. Well, why don't I have it? Because you've never planted the right seed. You always plant where you're being fed the word of God. If we're feeding you, you ought to be praying, Lord, what should I sow where I'm being fed the word? You can't plant seed in bad ground and wonder why it don't grow. It has to be good ground, the soil where the anointing is that feeds you the word of God. God gives seed to the sower. Now we found out that as we give, it comes back. How? Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. It will always be multiplied. My brothers and sisters, seed never produces just one seed. It always produces more. And you know what? As you sow that seed, a harvest is going to come back. But it says, shall men. So what is the, listen. When you pray and obey, sow the seed that God tells you for the harvest you want. You get to pick the harvest, but God gets to pick the seed. You sow in the measure he tells you, then he, God, speaks to men to walk into your life and to pour into your bosom the harvest of that seed. Are you getting a hold of this, my brothers and sisters? Nothing is coming from heaven. The house, the car, the job, everything you need is in your community. Well, why don't I have it? Why do some men have it? Because you haven't planted the right seed in the right soil. Amen? When you plant that seed, now it comes back. Then he gives a warning. Look out, for with the measure you give, it shall be measured back to you. My brothers and sisters, never got a harvest in hundreds till I planted my first $100 seed. I was going to Bible school. We were broke, had three kids at home. My wife and I had no money. We were both Bible school students, and a man gave me a $100 bill. Now listen, when you ain't got no money, $100 is a whole lot of money. We got that money was given to me. I was so excited. A man gave it to me that night. I was serving in another man's ministry, and God says, plant the seed. I said, what? No, I thought it was for me. God said, no, I'm not trying to take something from you, son. I've got something in hundreds I'm trying to give you. I obeyed God, planted that seed. That night, a lady walked up to me, gave me a check of $360. Somebody shout next. Why'd I get a harvest in hundreds? I had sowed in hundreds. We were about to graduate Bible school. I said, Lord, I need thousands of dollars to start this ministry. He said, I want you to plant 1,000. I said, Lord, that's all I got. He said, no, I'm not trying to take something from you, son. I don't need what you got. You need what I got. But I can't give you a measure you will not sow. My wife and I had the same number. We planted that $1,000 seed. On the night of graduation, somebody walked up to me, gave me a check of $16,500. Somebody shout next. Why'd I get a harvest in thousands? I had sowed in thousands. We were in debt in our building. This building, we wanted to get out of debt. I sowed in the measure I wanted to receive. 28 days later, somebody came into our ministry, and we've got this building paid off. But God's no respecter of persons. He'll do exactly the same for you. If you sow in the measure you want God to bless you, if you sow led by the Holy Ghost and the anointing where you're being fed the Word of God, God will tell you what to sow, when to sow, where to sow. Because that anointing that fed you, caused you to grow, is about to cause your seed to grow. And to do that, we've got many, many, many materials available to you. In fact, today, as you watch me, I'm going to actually pray with you to hear the voice of God. If this ministry has blessed you, then we're going to pray and say, Lord, what should I sow in this ministry that is feeding me the Word, and so that you can get the harvest you want to see in your life? Think about that. Be praying about that. We're going to get to that in just a second. But I want to talk about now growing in the Word. How do you grow in the Word? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. So we've got some materials for you. We want to bless you. Kingdom Principles of Financial Increase. My brothers and sisters, a lot of the teaching that you need right now to see finances, what is the role you play in your prosperity, the key to abundant living, reaping supernatural financial harvest, get a hold of this. This is going to be available to you. Invest in yourself. You are worth it. Also, we have some more CDs, 6 CDs in every packet, Managing Money God's Way, the difference between stewardship and ownership. Oh, you got to get a hold of that. The difference between saving money and growing money. Learning to hear God's voice in managing money. Get a hold of that, it'll bless you. And of course, harness the power of money. 4 financial dominion keys that will change your life. The laws of financial wisdom and going from debt to financial freedom. Just like we got out of debt, wouldn't you like to have supernatural debt cancellation? Get a hold of this. It's going to teach you and bless you. In fact, we also want to give you our free magazine. It's available to anybody. Just go to our website. You can download it. It's got all the testimonies and a lot of materials that can help you grow in the Word of God. Now, my brothers and sisters, Galatians 6:6 says, if you ever get blessed with the Word of God, it's right to sow into the anointing that fed you. Did we bless you with the teaching today? If we did, then I want you to pray about what to sow. there's a button there called Give Offering. If you'll click that button, you can go over to the website and you can make an offering right there. What happens? You pray. What do you want God to do? Four steps to your harvest. Step number one, you've got to determine what harvest you want from God. Give your seed a DNA. What do you want? God will let you pick the harvest on one condition. You've got to let him pick the seed. Step number two, you got to pray. Say, Lord, this ministry has blessed me. I'm sowing in good ground. It says if we get blessed, it's right to sow. The next verse says, don't you be deceived. God is not mocked. Don't ever, ever, ever get blessed with the word and then mock your father. Don't do that. Go to the give offering. Write down what you want. We're going to come into agreement with you. The Bible says where two agree praying is done by our Father in heaven. Then, once you've written down what you want, you pray. Say, Lord, what seed is going to bring it? In fact, in a minute, I'm going to pray with you that God is going to direct you with that seed. Then you plant that seed. You've got to pray and obey. Whatever God measure, he tells you, you pray and obey. Plant the seed that God tells you. For with the measure you give, it'll always come back. You give in hundreds, it comes back in hundreds. You give in thousands, it comes back in thousands. You will always receive in the measure that you give. And then as we pray for this seed, what seed should, in fact, let's do it right now. I really sense in my heart the anointing is all over this place, and it's coming right through the airwaves to you. Close your eyes. Thank you, Lord. We've heard the word today. The Bible says if we've been blessed, it's right here. Lord, would you speak to every person watching me on their cell phones, watching me on their iPads, watching me on their computers, every person that has been blessed with this teaching that has a need in their life. I know that that need won't never come to pass without the right seed. Would you speak to them to show what measure of seed is going to bring that home? Listen to your heart. If you're not sure you're hearing God, or if you end up with two figures, usually the bigger figure is God. If you're not sure you're hearing God, then you go to Luke 6:38. You always sow in the measure you want God to bless you. I want him to bless me in hundreds, sow in hundreds. I want to bless you in thousands. I want God to bless me in thousands, sow in thousands. You can go to that website, go to Click Offering, and then put in there your credit card information. We want to pray with you. We want to come into agreement. The Bible says we're two agree touching. It's done by our Father. We have so many testimonies of people that have sent in their seed and their harvest that they believe in God for. We've prayed, laid hands on it, and guess what? They've sent in their testimony. God is going to do exactly the same thing for you. Get those CDs. Get our free magazine. Just as you order, you can go and download it on our website. Send in your offering. Let's come into agreement for your harvest. Remember, harvest doesn't follow a prayer. Harvest doesn't follow a need. Harvest only follows a seed. Let me come into agreement with you for your harvest. Now, our next program coming up is going to be on prayer. And I encourage you to make sure you tune in, go to our website, find out. We'll send you on the Twitter. We will announce when it is. Make sure you get that information and join us for our Winning with Wisdom interactive program. But please go to our website. There's many upcoming events. There's conferences coming up, and I'm traveling all over the country. And of course, I would love for you to join me as I come. This is Dr. Nasser Siddiqui saying it's wonderful to study the word together on prosperity. I pray that you'll be a doer, not only a hearer, and that prosperity will come into your life. Thank you for joining me.